So last class, I had told you about the two conditions when both the signals are of infinite duration and when one of the signal is of finite duration and the other signal is of infinite duration. Now today, let me take an example where... Hello? So let me take an example of two signals here. So here you can see h of n and x of n, both are of finite duration. So you can see one signal is u of n minus u of n minus 3 and the other signal is u of n plus 1 minus u of n minus 3. So let us check how many samples these each of these signals have. Okay, so I think you all remember what is the expression for the convolution sum. Okay. So first let us find out how many samples are there. In u of n, since u of n is u of n minus u of n minus 3. So I have plotted here u of n is a unit step. So which is defined from 0 till infinity. And you have u of n minus 3, which is also a unit step, which is defined from 3 to infinity. So when you subtract these two, you will be getting only 3 samples. That is at 0, 1 and 2. H of k, I have not showed that plot, it's understood. So h of n is u of n plus 1 minus u of n minus 3. So u of n plus 1 means you will start from minus 1. Okay, minus of u of n minus 3. So from 3, all the samples will get cancelled. So you have only 4 samples here. So as the first step of convolution sum, what is the first step? Because we are going to find the convolution sum graphically, the first step is to sketch x of k and h of k. So as you can see, I have sketched here x of k and h of k. What is the next step? You have to fold h of k to get h of minus k, then shift h of minus k to get h of n minus k. Okay, that I'll be showing in the next slide. You can see. Yeah, see here. The first sketch is folding h of k to get h of minus k. Okay, folding is nothing but reversing the signal, okay, to get h of minus k. So you can see the limits of h of minus k. So the two limits are when n is when k is equal to minus 2 and when k is equal to plus 1. Now let me shift this h of minus k by n to get h of n minus k. So the two limits will be now n minus 2, which is corresponding to minus 2. It is n minus 2 and the other limit is n plus 1, which is corresponding to this plus 1. Okay. Now, let us check whether these two signals, say what is the process of convolution after getting h of minus k and after shifting the signal to get h of n minus k. It has to be multiplied with the first signal, that is x of k. Okay, to multiply, those two signals should overlap. Only then you can find out the convolution. So let us see what are the different cases under which these two signals overlap. And if they are overlapping, let us find out their product and in turn the convolution. So this is the case one. Now after shifting this, the second signal has to be moved, right? So moved in such a way that to check where the first signal and this signal will overlap. Now moving has to be in the right side. So see here, in this sketch I've plotted both x of k and h of n minus k. So this blue one is x of k and the red one is h of n minus k. Now you can see both the limits of h of n minus k, n minus 2 and n plus 1. Now I'm going for the first case where both n plus 1 and also n minus 2 are less than 0. Okay, so under this condition you can see there is no overlap between x of k and h of n minus k. So that results in this product equal to 0. So hence you cannot find out the convolution. So y of n is equal to 0. Now what I'll do, slowly I'll shift this h of n minus k to the right such that this n plus 1 will be greater than 0, but n minus 2 is still less than 0. That is the second case. So you can see here, I've shifted n plus 1 such that it is greater than 0, but still n minus 2 is less than 0. Now, when you see here, you can see there is an overlap between x of k and h of n minus k, and that too between 0 to n plus 1. So these two signals are getting overlapped between 0 to n plus 1. So let us find out their product between this 0 to n plus 1. And after finding the product, let us find out the convolution. So this is your convolution expression. Y of n is equal to summation of k varying from minus infinity to plus infinity x of k into h of n minus k. So x of k and h of n minus k both are 1, 1. So it is summation of, and from where to where they get overlapped? From 0 to n plus 1. So it is 0 to n plus 1 and their product is 1. So adding 1 from 0 to n plus 1, you will be getting n plus 2. Okay, this is when n plus 1 is greater than 0 and n minus 2 is less than 0. Now, I'll go to the next condition such that now even n minus 2 will become greater than 0. So let us see the next case. Yeah, see here. So both n plus 1 and n minus 2 are greater than 0. But how many samples the first signal had? The first signal had only 3 samples. So n minus 2 is greater than 0, but it is still less than this 2. That is the last sample of x of k. So now if you see, these two signals are getting overlapped from n minus 2 to 2. Okay. So let us find out their product and convolution. So the product is, you all know, both are unit step functions. So the values are 1 and 1. So x of k is 1, h of n minus k is also 1. So 1 into 1, it is 1. And from where to where we are taking the product? From n minus 2 to 2. So n minus 2 to 2. Now if you simplify this index, what you can do is take n minus 2 to the left hand side and equate to a variable and find out the u index. So then you will be getting summation of, if I take new variable as L, so you will be getting L is equal to 0 to 4 minus n. Okay, this I have showed you in properties of LTI system. Okay, so summation of 1 from L varying to 0 to 4 minus 1, so I'll be getting 5 minus n. Okay, so now we have considered a case where n minus 2 and n plus 1 both are greater than 0, but n minus 2 is less than the last sample of x of k. Now one more condition is when n minus 2 and n plus 1 are both greater than the last sample of x of k, greater than 2. Okay. So now you can see n minus 2 and n plus 1 are both greater than the last sample of x of k. So under this condition, you can see that there is no overlap between these two signals. So we'll be getting 0 product and 0 convolution. So this is about the convolution of two signals which are of finite duration. So as you recall, we had only two conditions when both the signals were of infinite duration, and we had three conditions when one was finite, the other one was infinite. Now the number of cases are more when compared to those two here, because both the signals are of finite duration. Okay. Now this is, you have three problems here. So based on whatever you have learnt in the convolution sum, please solve all these problems. Okay. It's an assignment. Okay. Now with this, let me move on to the next topic. Okay. So what is the next topic? Next topic is Fourier representation of the signals. Okay. Now, what do you mean by Fourier representation? Now, you just recall what you studied in LTI systems. In LTI systems, you came across convolution, which is where you understood that you represent the signal as weighted superposition of shifted impulses. Okay, so similarly, Fourier representation is nothing but we represent a signal as a weighted superposition of complex sinusoids. Any input signal x of t, or if you take x of n, discrete time or continuous time, we represent any signal as a weighted superposition of complex sinusoid. Now, if you give weighted superposition of complex sinusoids to a LTI system, then the output will be what? The responses, the weighted superposition of the responses to each of this complex sinusoid. So this analysis of signals and system using this sinusoidal representation, we are representing input, okay, which is by using a complex sinusoid, and your output is the response what you get from the system for this complex sinusoid. So here you are understanding the signals and system using sinusoidal representation. So this is known as Fourier analysis. Why Fourier? So this type of representation was given by the scientist named Joseph Fourier. So in his name, this is represented, known as Fourier analysis. Now, why is this important? Why should you go for learning this Fourier representation? So Fourier representation, it is helpful in characterizing various signals and system. So let us see some of the applications. Like characterizing the various signals and systems means you can use that for analysis of the signals. So analysis of the signals, and you can find out the response of LTI systems using Fourier analysis, and you can use it for various signal manipulations in digital signal processing. There are various areas in which Fourier analysis can be used, like image processing or communication. Okay, so wherever you come across a manipulation of the signal, this Fourier analysis can be used for analysis. Okay, now let us see. I told you, like, this is nothing but representing the input as a weighted superposition of complex sinusoids. In turn, the response of the system is the system response for a complex sinusoid. So for that, what I have done is, first I have taken a single sinusoid. Okay, so consider this is a LTI system. Okay, x of t is the input, y of t is the output. Now what I do is, I'll take the input. Now your input is nothing but a single complex sinusoid, which is e raised to j omega t. This is a sinusoid because you can represent e raised to j omega t as cos omega t plus j sin omega t. Now if I give this input to this system, you already know what is the output of an LTI system. Output of an LTI system is nothing but convolution of the input and the impulse response of the system. Okay, so y of t is nothing but we represent that as h of x of t, which is nothing but convolution of x of t and the impulse response of the system. Now when you give a complex sinusoid as the input to this LTI system, your output will be product of two terms. What are they? One of the term is the input itself, e raised to j omega t. This is the input, e raised to j omega t. And along with that, you will be getting another term, h of j omega. This is called as the frequency response of this system. So whenever you give a complex sinusoid to a LTI system, your output will be the product of the input and the frequency response of the system. Now what is this frequency response is given by? The frequency response of the system is given using its impulse response, h of t. So h of j omega is nothing but integration of h of tau integration of h of tau into e raise to minus j omega tau d tau as tau varies from minus infinity to plus infinity. Now this is the output. This is the output what you get for a single sinusoid. Okay, what you get for a single sinusoid. Now if I give weighted superposition of sinusoids, so let me consider that here. So you can see, if I consider x of t as weighted superposition, that is sum, weighted sum of many sinusoids. So here, as an example to show you, I have taken m sinusoids. So let us consider if your input is a weighted superposition of m sinusoids. So you can see there are m sinusoids here with weight. Here ak represents weight of each sinusoid. Now, what is the response of the system? See, for a single sinusoid, this is the response. The product of input and the frequency response of the system. So, for if you have m sinusoids, then I'll be getting m responses of the system, where each response is weighted. Okay, each response is weighted. And the response will have two terms. One is the input and the frequency response. That you can see here in the expression for y of t. So you can see here for one sinusoid, h of j omega into e raised to j omega t. Okay. So for m sinusoids, I have h of j omega k into e raised to j omega k t, where k is varying from 1 to m. And each of the output is also weighted. The input is weighted by factor ak, output is also weighted. So from this you can observe that if the input is a weighted superposition of complex sinusoids, output is also weighted sum of complex sinusoids with the weight ak and modified by the system frequency response. Okay, so this is the basics of Fourier analysis. Like, how do you represent the input as your input using complex sinusoids, and corresponding to that, what is the output? Now, this Fourier analysis or Fourier representations can be applied for four different classes of signals. So what are these four different, because with the different signal classes, the Fourier representation will also change. In general, it is Fourier representation. Now, when you apply this Fourier representation to different signal classes, they are called as, like I'll tell you, they are called as Fourier series and Fourier transform. When it is Fourier series and when it is Fourier transform. Now, I told you, you can apply for four different signal classes. So basically, we'll take two signal classes. One is the periodic signals, the other one is the non-periodic signals. So the Fourier series representation of periodic signals is called as Fourier series. Okay. So when you represent periodic signals, okay, using Fourier series representation, then we call it as Fourier series. When you represent non-periodic signals, okay, then we call that as Fourier transform. Okay, in general, it is Fourier representation. Okay, when you are going for periodic signals for Fourier representation, that is called as Fourier series. When you are going for Fourier representation for non-periodic signals, then it is called as Fourier transform. In turn, the periodic signals or the non-periodic signals can be either continuous time periodic signal and discrete time periodic signals. Okay. Even here, non-periodic signals, either it can be continuous time and discrete time. So based on that, if you are applying 4-year series for continuous time periodic, it is just 4-year series or continuous time Fourier series. You need not tell continuous time Fourier series, because 4-year series, it's understood that we have applied for continuous time periodic signals. And when you are representing discrete time periodic signals, we call that as discrete time Fourier series or DTFS. Okay. Now coming to the non-periodic signals, as I told you, Fourier representation for non-periodic signals, we call it as Fourier transform. And if you are going for continuous time non-periodic signal, it is just called as Fourier transform. And if you are representing discrete time signals and non-periodic, it is called as discrete time Fourier transform. Okay, so half of the current module deals with the Fourier series. Okay, and the next module you'll be studying about the Fourier transform. That is where we go for Fourier representation of non-periodic signals. Okay, now this I'll show to remember. I'll just show you this in as a table. So you can just see here. So I've made a table where you can just relate for continuous, discrete, whether it is periodic or non-periodic, which type of representation you can go for. So you can see here, when it is continuous, when it is continuous and periodic, we go for Fourier series. When it is continuous and non-periodic, we go for Fourier transform, the normal Fourier transform. And if it is a discrete time signal, periodic, then we are going for discrete time Fourier series. When the signal is discrete time and non-periodic in nature, we'll use discrete time Fourier transform. Okay. So this was about the Fourier representation for these four categories of signals. Fine. Now, to represent the Now I am just going with the Fourier series. Okay, so I'll start with the Fourier series of a signal which is periodic and which is continuous time signal. Okay, so how do you represent this continuous time periodic signal using Fourier representation? So how do you represent that signal? So here, this is your signal x of t, which is represented using Fourier series. Okay, so just remember, when you want to represent a signal using Fourier series, then the signal has to be continuous and periodic. Here I am referring to a continuous time signal x of t, which is periodic with period t. So this x of t is represented by summation of k varying from minus infinity to plus infinity x of k e raised to j k omega naught into t. Now you should know why we are using this e raised to j k omega naught into t. This is Fourier analysis. As I told in the beginning, Fourier analysis is nothing but representing signals and system using complex sinusoids. Okay, so in Fourier series, when the given signal is continuous time periodic, the given signal x of t is represented as summation of k varying from minus infinity to infinity x of k e raised to j k omega naught into t, where x of k is called as Fourier series coefficients of x of t. Fourier series. So this is how we represent the signal using Fourier series. Okay. So here omega naught, you know, it is the angular frequency given by 2 pi by t, and whose units is radian per second. And how do you find this Fourier series coefficient x of k? So x of k is given by 1 over t integral of x of t e raised to minus j k omega naught into t dt. So this integral of t, it is nothing but we are integrating for one period, Why? Because it is a periodic signal. Okay. So because it is a periodic signal, so we are integrating for one period. So the first equation where the signal is represented using the Fourier series coefficients x of k is called as the synthesis equation. Okay. And the next equation where you can see that the Fourier series coefficients x of k are computed by using the signal x of t. Okay. So this equation is called as analysis equation. Okay. The first equation is called as synthesis equation and the next equation is called as analysis equation. So first equation is representing the periodic signal using Fourier series coefficients. The second signal is finding the Fourier series coefficients by using the given periodic signal x of t. Okay. Now, so this is your Fourier series coefficient. What I want to tell this is, in the Fourier series coefficient equation x of k, as you substitute the different values of k, you will be getting x of 0, x of 1, so on. So in this, the x of 0th value is called as the average value or the DC value of the waveform. Okay. So now both the synthesis equation and the analysis equation, that is the equation for x of t and the equation for x of k. Using this, we can relate x of t and x of k as this. Okay. So both are related symbolically as this. That is, using x of t, I can compute x of k, and using the Fourier series coefficients x of k, I can represent x of t. Now, given any continuous time periodic signal, the Fourier series will not exist for that. Okay. So as I told you, we go for Fourier series representation when the given signal is a continuous time signal and it is periodic signal. But if the Fourier series has to exist, there are some conditions to be satisfied. And these conditions are called as Dirichlet's condition. Okay. So Dirichlet is the mathematician who proposed these conditions. These conditions represent what? Using this condition, we can analyze whether for a given signal, the Fourier series will exist or not. So let us see what are those conditions. The first condition is, if the signal x of t has to be represented by Fourier series, then it should have finite number of maxima and minima. So what is actually this finite number of maxima and minima? That means if you have any signal, something like this, it should have finite number of smallest values. See, this is the largest value. Okay. And this is the smallest value. So it should have finite number of smallest values and finite number of largest values within a given range. This smallest value and the largest value, they define the extremities of a signal. So those extremities should be finite in number. Now the next condition is, the function x of t should have finite number of discontinuities. Discontinuities, I can show you an example something else. See, this is a signal. This is a signal. And suddenly there is a discontinuity. So this is one discontinuity and this is one discontinuity. After which it continues and suddenly there is a discontinuity. Here there is a discontinuity and here there is a discontinuity. Okay. So the function should have finite number of discontinuities. And above all, the given functions should be stable. The given functions are to be stable. That means it has to be absolutely integrable. That means what? If I integrate this x of t over a period, the result what I get should be stable. That means it should be less than infinity. Okay. So, given any signal, the Fourier series of that signal will exist only when these conditions are satisfied. Okay. So please understand this. Fourier series, it is for continuous time signal and periodic. Yes, if the signal is continuous time and periodic, good. But if the Fourier series has to exist, it has to satisfy all these three Dirichlet's conditions. Now, coming to the amplitude and phase spectra of periodic signals. Now, when you are representing this, the given signal x of t using Fourier series coefficients, actually what are we doing? See, when you just go back to the slide where I showed, for the complex sinusoid, you will be getting the output from the LTA system, a product where one of the term is the frequency response, the other term is the input itself. So when you understand this, when you try to analyze this, you can see that the input, whatever we give to the system, it is in time domain. But the output, what I get from the system. So one of the term is the frequency response. That means when I represent a signal using Fourier representation, what we are doing is we are transforming the signal from the time domain to the other domain, frequency domain. Okay. So yeah, why we are doing that? For analysis of signals and systems. Okay. So in frequency domain, the signal what we get, that is called as the spectrum of the signal. Okay. In time domain, the signal what we are giving, okay, in response to that, whatever signal we get out after applying this Fourier analysis, that is called as the spectrum. So let us see what is this amplitude and phase spectra of periodic signals. Now we are analyzing what? Fourier series. So for the given signal x of t, we have represented that using Fourier series coefficients x of k, right? So this x of k has two components. If I am going for complex Fourier coefficient, this Fourier coefficient x of k will have two components. What are they? One is the real part of the complex coefficient and other one is the imaginary part of the complex coefficient. Okay. So from this, I can find out what is the magnitude of this Fourier coefficients. The magnitude is given by magnitude. You all know, whenever you have a complex quantity, how do you find out the magnitude? Magnitude is square root of the square of the real component plus the square of the imaginary component. And phase angle of x of k is given by tan inverse of the imaginary component divided by the real component. So the plot of the magnitude. So if you are plotting k versus the magnitude of x of k, then it is called as the magnitude spectrum. And if you are plotting k versus angle of x of k, then it is called as the phase spectrum. Okay. While doing the properties of signals and various operations on the signals, I had told if the given signal is a complex quantity, then if you take the conjugate of the signal, the conjugate will be same as x of minus k. Please remember. So if you apply this here, so our complex Fourier coefficient is x of k, which is A of k plus j b of k. So if I take complex conjugate of that, it will be equal to x of minus k. Okay, so if you use this condition, then the magnitude of Fourier coefficient x of k will be same as x of minus k, whereas theta of minus k will be equal to minus theta of k. You know what is theta of k? Theta of k is nothing but the phase of x of k. Okay, so if x of k is equal to x of minus k, that means it is satisfying the even property. And if theta of minus k is equal to minus theta of k, it is satisfying the odd signal property. So from this we can say that amplitude spectrum is a even function of k and phase spectrum is a odd function of k. Okay, so we concentrate on the equations and this spectrum. The next class will be taking few examples on the Fourier series coefficients.